The atmosphere, fresh air. You just can't beat it. Take it away and, well, real estate values are going to fall into a deep slump. Astronomers, myself included, have spent a fortune doing their best to get to high altitudes and get as much of the atmosphere as possible below their telescopes. But how can we get better views with our telescopes if we don't want to climb a mountain or tiny planet man's stratospheric ladder? I'll show you how, right after the owl. This video was sponsored by Brilliant. In this video, I'm going to discuss why your telescope views are fuzzy or blurry and what you can do about it. I'm aiming this video typically at people who have just purchased or received a new astronomy telescope and are concerned about the disappointing views they may have experienced in their first few uses of the telescope. In fact, even if you've had one or two what you consider to be good views, I'd still like you to see this video so that your views can get even better and you'll be better placed to understand the pattern that underlies why your views might be varying in their quality. Tiny Planet Man is undoubtedly correct when he says that putting as much of the Earth's damp, turbulent and dirty atmosphere below our telescopes is a good way of improving our views, and even better, putting your telescope in orbit above the atmosphere. But if climbing mountains with a telescope strapped to your back doesn't appeal to you, and you haven't got the twiddly billion clams you need to put it in orbit, this video is designed to help you. I'm going to deal with how to avoid blurry, disappointing telescope views, or more properly, avoid the negative impact of astronomical instrument and atmospheric seeing effects. I'm going to try to avoid too many assumptions, and my simple mission is to send you away armed with three simple rules, or laws. These are my personal laws, and with apologies to Isaac Asimov, this is not iRobot. This is iRobot. And I'm going to tell you my three laws of, not robotics, but telescopics. My three laws of telescopics, helping you to observe three laws safe and avoid the worst effects of air turbulence that spoil your eyepiece views. So if you're a newbie astronomer disappointed by fuzzy, jiggly, blurry underwater images of planets and lunar craters in the eyepiece of your new telescope, whether you paid $50, $500 or $5,000, pounds or euros, I'm talking to you. Even if you're a more experienced telescope user, frustrated by the seemingly random quality of your views, I may have something for you too, so stick around. Probably no subject comes up more regularly, either directly or indirectly, than requests for help to improve poor quality, blurry, fuzzy eyepiece views. This comment received on the channel is pretty typical of many we receive, articulating the frustration and disappointment many telescope users experience. Hey man, I have the 6-inch Dobsonian. Any way to make it zoom in on, say, Mars, come into focus and not be an energy blob? It's crisp and clear, but only when seeing it as a tiny dot. Ha ha. Well, I sympathize with EM. Energy blob says it nicely. And I and a lot of people watching know exactly what you mean. So EM, and this video's for you and anyone else frustrated by views of energy blob planets. We need to talk about air. Now, if I ask you to imagine a completely empty room, you'll probably picture a bare room, window, door, ceiling with a bare light bulb hanging, and floorboards. It's unlikely you will have remembered to remove the air from the room and imagine it in a vacuum. We hardly ever think about this stuff. Air, it's gas. I've got a cubic inch of the gassy stuff here. The space inside this box is 1 cubic inch, or 16,387 square millimeters. Rolls off the tongue, doesn't it? So how many particles of stuff is that? Well, it's a big number. is about 400 quintillion particles, and I have no idea what that means. But a typical fast modern computer can count to a billion in less than 10 seconds. But to count what's in here would take about 1,000 years. Better put it back in case it's missed. Now, we tend to think this stuff is everywhere. It isn't, of course, but it is inside our telescope tubes. Here's an empty telescope tube. And of course, just like the room, it isn't empty. It's full of air at a pressure of approximately 1 atmosphere. Now, a good telescope, even a cheap one, maintains a quarter wavelength accuracy for all parts of the light wave that enters the telescope tube and comes to a focus at our eye. But the air inside this 2-foot-long telescope tube retards the light wave by about 250 wavelengths of light, making the air a significant part of the optical system, whether we like it or not. If we had a magic wand, we could force the air to affect every part of the light wave equally. But unfortunately, if the refractive index of the air in any part of the telescope tube varies by more than one part in 1500, it will exceed the quarter wave tolerance limit and result in reduced quality of our views. Such a variation can occur in a slight temperature difference of just 0.2 degrees centigrade. But don't forget, we aren't looking through just 2 feet of air or mixed gas and water vapor in our telescope tube. The cylinder of air we're looking through reaches all the way to the top of the atmosphere. Now, described like this, it seems like a miracle that we see anything at all. In fact, we can see wonderful things. But we need to think a little about the optical consequences of living at the bottom of this constantly moving sea of gas if we want to get the best views with our telescopes. Now, you may have only paid $150, pounds or euros for the small Newtonian telescope that you bought on Amazon. And even though they didn't tell you, your telescope relies on a moment of spellbinding human genius, one of the great masterworks of humankind, the astounding accuracy of manufacture of the astronomical telescope mirror. The accuracy of its surface curvature is anything from 100 to 160 times more accurately made than the most vital moving parts of your motor car. And we've been able to do this magic for 300 years. We are truly remarkable creatures.
But remember, wild weasels and rattlesnakes make better pets.
If anyone asks you, what's the most precise and lovely thing you own, you're probably unlikely to point to the mirror in that $150 telescope. But you should. For a telescope mirror to work, the glass has to be polished to an accuracy of 25 nanometers, or a millionth of an inch. And this is all done just so that the glass can carry a fantastically thin layer of vacuum-deposited aluminium of about 100 nanometers or 1,000 angstroms thickness. It's not easy to understand just how precise all of this is. But take this 5-inch mirror and expand it to the diameter of a mile, or 1.6 kilometers, if you can imagine a mirror a mile across. The surface would be figured to an accuracy of 0.25 millimeter. Or the thickness of a playing card. At the same scale, to represent the accuracy of the most finely machined parts of a motor car, I'd need 3 decks of cards to cover the 4 microns or 4,000 nanometers accuracy demanded by a motor car engine. Now, the point of that little peroration about mirror quality is to encourage you to trust the quality of our modern astronomical telescope mirrors and lenses and not write them off as inadequate, as so many people do, just because you didn't get good views with them right away. It's like throwing away new, perfectly good fishing tackle just because you didn't catch any fish. Think it possible that it's not the tackle, and there's another explanation. Okay, let's forget about the large-scale air movements in our atmosphere for the moment and start closer to home and think about the spoiling disturbances in the air inside our telescopes. Now, talking about air molecules and things going on in secret in the telescope tube, I think is not terribly memorable. So I want to reinforce this idea of the importance of what's going on above the surface of the mirror by showing you something that I'm hoping you can carry with you for the rest of your telescopic career and make this your own And I'm going to show you something that I think is a quite impressive way of demonstrating actually what's going on in secret above the surface of your mirror of your telescope. So I've gone to the trouble of setting up a Schlieren imaging system here that's going to let me show you the relatively subtle changes in air density above the mirror. Now, I think we've probably all seen the visual appearance when the optical view has been disturbed by rising heat. I pestered my wife while she was doing some cooking in the kitchen and pointed the camera across the top of the frying pan here, and you can see the effect that the heat from the rising from the frying pan had on the quality of the view that I was getting in the background there.
You know you're spoiling my experiment, right?
It's not an experiment, it's breakfast.
So you say.
Now, seeing it when the temperature is very high is fairly easy, and we're used to seeing that heat shimmering on the road and things like that. But the kind of disturbances that I'm talking about are much more subtle, and I think they're much harder for you to believe in unless you actually see it with your own eyes. So I've set this up in the hope that you will remember this for the entirety of your career with a telescope, and that this is sufficiently vivid, this demonstration, that you will make it your own. And you'll remember this every time you set up your telescope. So what have we got? I've got a 8 3/4, that's about 220 millimeter mirror here, Newtonian telescope mirror. And I've set up a camera, a little video camera, at about twice the focal length away. I've set it up with a knife edge next to it. And right next to it here is an automotive lamp, which I've rotated slightly so that it presents a almost a point source of light. And I've got that connected up to this transformer. And I'm going to put just a little bit over 10 volts through that. And you should be able to see something on the, on the camera there. So the way I've got this set up is fairly intriguing, and I'm not going to go into it in too much detail. You'll have to look up Schlieren photography somewhere else, but it is quite interesting. But you can see that if I put my hand into the view here, you can actually see what looks like smoke rising from the surface of my hand. And it's just the warmth of my hand causing this. Okay, so what I'm going to do now is collect that mirror, which has been staying in the warm, and just introduce it into the image here so that you can see what's going on. It's been sitting in my nice warm office, and here it is. I'm just going to put it on the end here, and then
just introduce it into the big mirror's light path.
There we are. And you can see what's going on there. It almost looks like smoke rising from the surface of the mirror. It's picking up these very subtle changes in the air density above the mirror and showing it to you as these darker areas. And you can see that they, as I move the mirror around, they move around, I think, pretty much as you would expect, like smoke. And you can see, if I waggle this up and down, it actually performs rather like smoke. So, don't need the gloves anymore. Now, the whole point about this very elaborate Schlieren imaging episode was to show you something you normally can't see. And in a way, you're going to have to go through the rest of your telescopic career not being able to see this heat. And the whole point about this segment was really to show you that. And I cannot stress enough the importance of allowing your telescope to reach ambient temperature if you're expecting to make good high-resolution observations with it. This really is very important. In fact, if you probably only took that away from this video, I'd probably be quite pleased if you remembered that one thing. Remember to allow your instrument to achieve some kind of parity with the temperature at the observing site. Okay, now we're ready for my first law of Telescopics for getting better views with your telescope. Always allow the instrument to reach equilibrium with the outdoor ambient temperature, or at least get a lot closer to it by putting the telescope outside at least 25 minutes before you intend to use it. This is for a 3-inch or a 75 to 85 mil telescope. Add at least 5 to 7 minutes for each inch or 25 mil of aperture after that. The bigger the temperature disparity between where you store the instrument and the observing site, the longer you need to leave it out for the temperature to equalize. So storing the telescope well covered but in an unheated garage is a good idea. But remember, the garage is still at a different temperature to the outside. After all, if you had to, where would you rather sleep in winter? Outside or in your garage? This is important. Remember that Schlieren demonstration. You won't get good views while your telescope optics are rapidly cooling down, or for that matter, quickly warming up. If you live in a hot climate and your telescope is stored in air-conditioned comfort, follow the rule just the same. Put your telescope outside and let it warm up before using it. Okay, let's go back to thinking about disturbances that are further away from our telescopes for rule or law number two. For this, we need to start thinking about the atmosphere on a large scale. We've got our Earth model here, and we can see pretty clearly the continent of Africa, and we can see these equatorial region here, very dry looking, and we can see Europe up here, and the funny little island where I was born, just off the coast of mainland Europe, up here, and we can see America over here stretched out, the continental USA. I can see Florida all the way down here, for example, and we can see the eastern seaboard up here. Anyway, most people live in this temperate zone wrapped around here. That's where most of you who are watching me are actually living. And on this scale, this Earth model here is a meter in diameter. So it's a meter wide, and that's equivalent to 39 inches or 3 inches less than a yard. So a millimeter on this scale is equal to about 11.7 kilometers. That's about 8 miles. And for the purposes of our discussion, I'm going to define the depth of the atmosphere in accordance with the von Karman line, which is 100 kilometers or about 62 miles. Just to give you an idea of what that looks like, I'm going to use my trusty cards again. The 100 kilometers or 62 miles on this scale is equivalent to 28 playing cards, or two suits and two jokers. Okay, so let's lay that on the middle of Europe there. There we go. Let's get it to fit nicely. There's the depth of the atmosphere. Now, of course, the atmosphere does vary slightly. You may remember that it gets a little bit thinner at the poles, a bit colder up here, and the air gets a bit denser, and a little bit, the atmosphere gets a little bit thinner up here, but only by a few kilometers and or a few miles. And the same down here in the, as we move towards the equator, the atmosphere gets a little bit thicker. So it's a little bit less dense, but to compensate, it gets a little bit thicker as we move down towards the equator and the warmer regions. But in this temperate zone where most of us are living, the atmosphere stays a fairly steady thickness. And for the purposes of our discussion, we are going to think about that being within the Karman line, which is this 100 kilometer or 62 miles. So that's the thickness of the atmosphere. Now, bear in mind that a good chunk of that 100 kilometers doesn't really bother our telescopes that much, because as we move to the an altitude of around about 100 kilometers, 60 miles, the air actually up there is too thin to fly an aircraft. We can't breathe up there. That's really pretty high, and there's not a lot of stuff around. So that top part of that atmospheric stack doesn't really do our telescopes that much harm. It's as we come down and the air gets denser and denser to the bottom where we're living here at ground level, where the atmosphere gets pretty thick and soggy and dense and dirty. And that's the bit we really need to worry about when we're thinking about our telescopes. Just to put this distance in some sort of context so you can understand it. If we think about where our satellites and the International Space Station are orbiting, it's tempting to think on an image like this they would be up here somewhere, rather like a 1950s model of the atom, the nucleus down here and the electrons flying around up here. In actual fact, the International Space Station is normally at about 400 kilometers. So on this scale, I'm using another card, an SD card this time. That's what 400 kilometers looks like, or about 250 miles. That's where the International Space Station is orbiting the Earth. So if you're not impressed by that and you don't think that's all that high and it's hardly to be considered deep space exploration, bear in mind that you and I, when we've been on airliners, just three playing cards width at 35,000 feet, it's down there somewhere, about 0.8 of a millimeter, you can see it's impressively above us, in fact, where the space station is actually orbiting, and a long way above the atmosphere that I'm talking about. Now, you can understand, I think, why NASA has spent $2.5 billion putting telescopes, even quite small ones, in orbit. So though the telescopes in orbit are far from being gigantic, they're quite modest-sized telescopes, they do have an enormous advantage in not being spoilt by this layer of atmosphere. It's rather galling to think that we watch things in the night sky, or when we're looking at planets, the light has come millions, billions, and even trillions and quadrillions of miles across space, only to be spoiled in the last 1% of 1% of 1% of the journey in this last 100 kilometers, 60 miles down to the ground. That really is something of a shame. But the good news is there are things we can do to try to make sure that we get the best possible views in our telescopes. Now, the main thing I wanted you to get from this little discussion is the idea, which I think you probably learned at school, that the atmosphere of the Earth is an even coating around the Earth. Even though it's fairly thin like this, it's like the skin of an orange and it's all the way around. And that's because I'm going to contradict it and tell you something completely different. And the reason for that is we are thinking about our telescopes. And from the perspective of our telescopes, things look a little bit different. Now, from the point of view of the telescope, that even atmospheric coating around the Earth isn't actually even. It's wedge-shaped. Now, this might seem peculiar, but just think about it for a moment. If I point the telescope directly overhead, straight up vertically, I'm looking through about 60 miles of gas before I get out into space. The atmosphere is only about 60 miles deep, and it's also, for a good part of that 60 miles, it's actually quite rarefied at the top of that. But in principle, there's gas up to about 60 miles. That's about 100 kilometers. But if I come down and point the telescope directly at the horizon, before I get to the upper reaches of the atmosphere in that direction and get out into space, the light beam needs to pass through about 690 miles of air, or about 1,100 kilometers. So that's a long way for the light beam to go through thick, soggy air. So you can see now that as I come up from 0 degrees, where the atmosphere is at its thickest, it gradually gets thinner and thinner and thinner until I get directly overhead, where it's at its thinnest. Consequently, the atmosphere from the telescope is wedge-shaped. Now, we can beat that. Looking at where the atmosphere gives its, let's say, its sweet spot, where it starts to get thinner and gives us a reasonable view of the sky. And that's at about 35 degrees. So now we've worked out how to do 90 degrees and 0 degrees. So now come up halfway, which would be 45 degrees. And now fist widths down. Don't forget, keep your arm out straight. Come down from that point by the width of a fist just here. And now we're pointing at 35 degrees. And a good thing to do from your observing site is to hold that position and go around in a circle and actually look at how much of your local terrain, I had to go over the telescope, how much of your local terrain is actually underneath that 35 degrees. I find from where I'm standing here, for example, it's one of the reasons why these telescopes are positioned just here, is that A lot of the obstructions that I've got quite near my instruments are underneath that 35 degrees, and they're giving me a bit of shelter rather than actually obscuring my view of the sky. So don't be too worried about things that are near you. Just think about that 35 degree rule. Now, does it mean there's an absolute embargo on looking at things that are under 35 degrees? Well, if there's a building in the way, then clearly there is. But do we follow the rule of not looking at things of under 35 degrees? No, of course not. Obviously, if there is a target that is a delight to look at and it's well under 35 degrees, why not look at it? Of course. The point is that if it's a detailed target, like a planet or the moon, just don't expect your telescope to be providing you with the best resolution when the target is under 35 degrees. That's all this is really saying. Just remember that underneath 35 degrees, from this zone here down to the horizon, the air is pretty thick and dirty and dense, and it absorbs a lot of the light that's going through it. Plus, there's lots of thermal activity going on, and you'll get a very disturbed view. So if you do view things under 35 degrees, don't expect the views in your telescope to be at their best. So now we're ready for my second law of telescopics to guarantee better views. This is the very easy to remember 35 degree rule. If you do point at targets under 35 degrees altitude, don't blame your instrument if you don't get the best views. If you're looking at a planet too low in the east, be patient. Wait for it to move to a higher altitude a few hours later. Use an astronomy app to do just enough planning before your observing session so you have a chance of getting better views. The central part of the second law is thinking critically about your observing site and looking for sources of air disturbance. Recognizing that the air below 35 degrees is rarely ideal for planet viewing should also help condition you to look for other sources of air disturbance near your observing site. So now we come to my third and final law of telescopics. This one's a little bit tricky to sell, as you won't like it as much as the first two, because with this one, you've got to actually do something rather than just avoid doing something, so it's a bit harder. But in its way, it's more significant than the other two. To advise you, I'm going to draw on the experience of a trusted astronomer who, over the years, has had a very significant influence on my entire career using telescopes. The astronomer I'm referring to is this one. Yep, that's me, aged 14. We'll pause for a moment so that you can get it out of your system. Laugh it up. How did that boy turn into that fat bearded gammon? Ha ha! Okay, all done? If we can all get on now. I was introduced to astronomy by a school friend. I'll name him here because we last saw one another when I was about 19, and sadly, we lost contact after that. And he probably has no idea of the extent that his influence changed my life. Detlef Anderson, if you're watching, hello, and thanks for all those discussions we had about astronomy and science on the roads of Littleport. The very first telescope I used to look at the night sky was like this one. It was a 1916 British Army three-draw spotter owned by my father. It had two eyepieces, a high and a low, rather than the pancratic or zoom eyepiece of this civilian version. But in all other respects, it was the same. I made a tripod for it, my first attempt at telescope accessory design. It was made from the remains of an old television aerial, and it was woefully inadequate. And this is one of the last remaining parts of that telescope. I keep it nearby as a reminder. I made my earliest observations of a conjunction of Venus and Mercury looking through this tube, with the telescope wedged in the fork of a poplar tree. Sadly, most of the rest of the instrument is lost, plundered over the next few years for what, at the time, seemed like vital projects of one kind or another. Later, thanks to the efforts of my mother and my brother in 1974, I was upgraded to this telescope, a Japanese Circle T 80mm or 3-inch refractor. This is not the actual one. This is a specimen I purchased in the spasm of nostalgia only a decade or so ago. Mine was branded S&S and was purchased from Mark Schaffel's late great scientific and technical. Mark Schaffel binoculars, anyone? In fact, I've got a bit of a soft spot for this type of refractor, and I now have several versions in my collection. But anyway, this is the version I had as a boy. Now, my problem then, and the problem we are discussing today, was the same. I had this telescope, and I'd been reading books like this classic by Patrick Moore, reading, I might say, with the obsessive diligence that only a young teenager can. And although he was a marvellous guide on how to behave at the eyepiece end of a telescope, he didn't write about telescopes like mine. He always talked about a mythical quality 3-inch English refractor. When he talked about seeing conditions and transparency, he and others recommended various numerical scales to assess these phenomena, the Pickering 10-point scale, the Antoniadi 5-point scale, amongst others. I, like a lot of people still today, had no idea how my instrument compared with these. Quality telescopes, he spoke of. I didn't feel I could make a detailed judgment about sky conditions until I knew what to expect from my telescope. I was confused and a bit frustrated at the lack of clear information available to me. The basic problem was I simply hadn't made enough good observations in good to excellent seeing conditions to be able to evaluate how good or bad my telescope was. So I felt a bit trapped. Was it seeing or was it my telescope? Was my telescope one of those poor quality instruments Patrick Moore was hinting at without actually mentioning them? I couldn't refine my expectations of my telescope because I couldn't be sure of the seeing conditions, and I couldn't define the seeing conditions because I wasn't sure about the contribution made to the image by my telescope. I was going around in circles. So that snotty 14-year-old boy did something that I'm going to recommend to you. I've recommended it hundreds of times over the years because I know it works, and it's this. Keep a simple diary or basic log of some important details of every observation you make with your telescope. See, I told you you wouldn't like it. Now, I recommend you do this all the time because it adds to your enjoyment and deepens the experience. But today, I'm only recommending that you keep a log at least until you feel confident about the performance of your instrument and until you've really seen what it can do in a range of observing conditions. And that might take some months. It certainly did for me. Now, for a start, if you've seen any seeing scales and numerical systems to evaluate seeing and transparency, forget them. If you've never heard of them, great. You can go back and look at them later after you're making real progress with your telescope. They have their place, and by all means, explore them when you're more confident about what your telescope can do. But for now, don't do anything that means you have to learn someone else's complicated way of judging the sky conditions. Trust me. Well, trust the snotty boy anyway. You already have the skills you need to do this. Now, you can download observing log pages from the internet if you must, but I just used an old exercise book, and I definitely don't recommend diaries, old or new. You'll be tempted to use the day-date page, and then you'll end up with weeks or months of blank pages between observing nights. Everybody does. Now, you're not doing this for posterity. It's not literature. It's best not to be too wordy. The more you make a rod for your own back by writing too much, the less likely you are to do it next time. Face it, we're lazy animals. Just put down basic facts, like a shopping list. Remember, this is for you, nobody else. Ideally, I want you to record the date and the time of the start of your observing session. And this is not for a peer-reviewed publication. Approximate times will do. Make brief notes about what it looked like and record the seeing conditions you witness in the eyepiece using the crudest scale you can think of. Say, three possibilities. Does the view look good to you, bad, or medium? For the first few nights, you might just use good or bad. How do you know where the middle is? You've only just started, right? Before you end the session, record your opinions again. Was there any difference? Has the weather changed? Have clouds moved in? Keep the details simple and descriptive. In the end, it should only be a few lines.
It can be useful to add a limiting magnitude as a measure of sky transparency to your log. And rather than use an astronomy app that will spoil your dark adapted vision, you can download and print a page from freestarcharts.com to help you estimate the faintest overhead stars you can see with the naked eye. For local weather cell details, apps like WeatherPro can give you reasonably accurate current situation details, as well as useful screens showing evolving radar and satellite pictures.
Now run the satellite demonstration.
But you can also include information from your own rooftop weather station in your log. as measures, what they lack in absolute accuracy and wider applicability, they more than make up for with consistency and observing sight relevance. These things are not expensive and they're a lot of fun and make it very easy to add up-to-the-minute point-blank weather data at the beginning and end of your observing session.
The idea is to help you to remember the difference between one night and another, and to create a simple judgment framework where you'll be able to spot improvements when they appear. I can't recommend this procedure enough. I promise you won't end up with a stack of observations that are just good or bad. You'll realize, after not too many sessions at the telescope, that your idea of each value needs to be expanded to accommodate the variations you've seen, but allow this to grow naturally. In my case, it took a while. What with it being the summer of 73 when I started astronomy with a telescope, and I had restrictions on how late I could stay up on a school night. I still do. But eventually, by recording my experiences, I could see patterns in the changes in seeing, and it correlated with my local weather. And I noticed that improvements in my eyepiece views correlated with both the length of time I'd been observing on a particular night and how long after sunset I was observing. As a result, I realized that instrument and air temperature were both playing a role in determining the quality of the views. It was a great relief to discover that my telescope was good, very good, and was not the cause of my poorest views. Now, beyond my first two laws of telescopics, I can't give you a list of universal rules for guaranteeing the best views from every observing site. Every site varies. That's why it's so important to keep a log, so that you can spot patterns in the conditions and relate them to the observing experiences that you actually have. If that spotty boy in 1973 can do it, so can you. Now, thinking caps on, let's get a bit more scientific rigor in our discussion by looking at the transfer function as it applies to Tartaski's model of turbulence. Then again, let's not. I don't think it will help us get better views with our small telescopes. Instead, I want to expose you to the idea of how seeing appears in the eyepiece of our telescopes so that you can get some sense of what I'm talking about when I say that you're going to experience a range of seeing conditions from poor to excellent. I'm going to do this by using some great video clips of the planet Jupiter recorded by my old friend Damien Peach. The images were all shot with a monochrome camera using a Celestron C14. First up, extremely poor seeing. And here's our friend the energy blob, jumping around, looks like it's underwater, no reliable surface detail to speak of. Nasty. Next, very poor seeing. Still a bit of an energy blob, really. We can see a few light and dark bands, but no detail, and its variations in position are about 5 to 10% of the disk diameter. Now we have poor seeing. It's better. We can see some cloud belt detail, but the image is still shimmying around like it's underwater. Next, fair seeing. It's a notch or half a notch better, a little bit steadier. At an eyepiece, because of the way the eye works, details will seem to pop out of the fuzz, so you can actually get some nice views with only fair seeing like this. Next is good seeing. A lot less movement of the disc and finer detail visible. And finally, excellent seeing. A lot steadier with sustained fine detail. And such image drift as there is has a sustained look to it, not so many reversals and flapping about like a flag in the wind as we saw in the poor seeing conditions. Now, I showed you those clips to give you a sense of the range of sky conditions we encounter with our telescopes, but also to give you a feel for how different one observing period can be from another. Now, once you've got this very basic regime of note-taking and recording working for you, and it becomes useful and practical and less of a nuisance to do, you can start adding to it a little bit. Now, we've covered this in our back catalogue, so I won't go into too much detail now, but a good addition would be to regularly record the results of a star test. A simple star test is just another way of allowing you to assess the sky conditions in a consistent way, and again, build up this sense of familiarity with the conditions that are excellent, good, moderate, or bad. It involves no more than looking at a fairly bright star always with the same moderate to high power eyepiece, and always at roughly the same high altitude, certainly above 50 degrees. The idea is to develop a better feel for the seeing conditions. Again, nothing too fancy to start with, just note the basic facts of what you see at the eyepiece. How does the star look as you move the telescope in and out of focus? Can you see rings forming around the star? Are the rings continuous or broken? Is the star jiggling around? Can you see a settled star point at all through the jiggling? At the back of your mind, by all means, think about pursuing perfect views. But to approach this, we first need to climb the ladder of simply better views. No words of mine will encourage you to do more and better astronomy like the steady acquisition of better views. You'll barely have to think about the process of improvement. My hope is it will come to you naturally. My three rules, or laws of telescopics, should give you a good start. Now, you've followed me so far, and I've been betting on you being keen to learn new skills. And if you're looking for a free, effortless, fun way to deepen your understanding of astrophysics and astronomy, look no further than the sponsor of today's video, brilliant.org. Brilliant is by far the most engaging online platform to learn science subjects, maths, and data science interactively. I'm using it myself. I've been deepening my understanding of some aspects of calculus to help with my work understanding and then explaining the mathematics of missile guidance. And I love the astrophysics course. I always knew that doing astronomy was fun, but I didn't realize that learning astrophysics could be fun too. Brilliant lets you explore the world of physics with interactive quizzes and animated visual aids, and it's perfect for those of us who think we're too busy to learn anything new. Brilliant's courses are designed to fit into your busy schedule. With just 10 to 15 minutes a day, you can start learning important concepts. For me, the smartest thing about Brilliant is that somehow they made learning fun, making it addictive. To try everything that Brilliant has to offer, free for a full 30 days, visit brilliant.org/astronomyandnaturetv or click on the link in the description below this video. The first 200 people to sign up with that link will get 20% off an annual premium subscription. You don't want to miss our next video, so don't forget to subscribe and click the bell icon so that you get a notification when we upload something new. Thanks for watching. Until next time, bye for now.